very learned and judicious remark was received with a genuine smile of approbation by all the company. All I mean but your humble servant, who endeavoring to keep my gravity as well as I could. This very learned and judicious remark, as the remark is a statement which is made by the gentleman of England, who describes the demerits of the other people who belongs to other nations of Europe, and he describes that an Englishman is having all the virtues. And this remark was received with a general smile of approval by all the company, all the gentlemen who were present there. All here refers to other five people except the author. He says, all I mean but your humble servant. Humble servant here refers to Oliver Goldsmith. So he wants to say that all other gentlemen were agreed with that statement, with that remark, but the author was not agreed with it. Then what he was doing? He says, who endeavoring to keep my gravity as well as I could. He was trying to keep his seriousness as well as he could. I reclined my head upon my arm. The author reclined his head upon his arm. Continued for some time in a posture of affected thoughtfulness. And for some time, he remained in a posture of thoughtfulness. He wanted to show them that he was thinking on some other topic, as if I had been musing on something else, as if he was musing on some other topic and did not seem to attend to the subject of conversation. And by doing so, the author wanted to show those people, those gentlemen, that he is not participating in the subject of their conversation. And why he was pretending so? He tells the reason, hoping by these means to avoid the disagreeable necessity of explaining myself. The author hoped that by doing so, he could avoid the necessity of explaining himself. Actually, he did not want to explain his own views regarding this statement, and he knew, because he knew that if he would have explained that, those people would have been disagreed with him. That's why he was avoiding it and thereby depriving the gentleman of his imaginary happiness. And if the writer had explained his statement, his views regarding this statement, what would have happened? That gentleman would have been deprived of his imaginary happiness. So here author wants to say Oliver Goldsmith has described an incident, and by describing it he wants to say that he was in not favor of that statement which was made by an Englishman. He further says, but my pseudo-patriot had no mind to let me escape so easily. Here pseudo-patriot, pseudo means false. So the person who was making that statement was not a patriot in real sense. He is called here pseudo-patriot. But that pseudo-patriot had no mind. He did not want to let the author escape so easily. Not satisfied that his opinion should pass without contradiction. It seemed that gentleman was not satisfied that his opinion should pass without contradiction. He was determined, that gentleman was determined to have it ratified by the suffrage of everyone in the company. That gentleman was determined to have it approved by the approval of every person in the company. All five members who were present with him, they were agreed with him, but the author tried to escape or ignore that point. That's why what he did, for which purpose? addressing himself to me with an air of inexpressible confidence. That's why the gentleman addressed to Oliver Goldsmith, and when he was addressing to the author, the expression on his face was showing that he was extremely confident about his thought. He asked author if I was not in the same way of thinking, whether Oliver Goldsmith was also not thinking in the same way. As I am never forward in giving my opinion, especially when I have reason to believe that it will not be agreeable. Here Goldsmith says that he never come forward to give his opinion when he knows that it will not be accepted by other people, or other people will not be agree with it. So when I am obliged to give it, but when anybody insists him to give his opinion, he says, I always hold it for a maxim to speak my real sentiment. He says, if anybody asks me, anybody insists me to give my opinion, then I always present my real feelings. For the happiness of other people or to make them happy, he never agreed with them. So he says, I therefore told him, for my own part, I should not have ventured to talk in such a perfunctory strain unless I had made the tour of Europe and examined the manners of these several nations with great care and accuracy. That perhaps, he says, that I am not in the position of explaining about the people of other countries because I have not visited to them and I have not observed their manners. Unless I not able to make the tour of Europe and examine the manners of these people, I cannot make any statement. He said so. But he says, a more impartial judge would not hesitate to affirm that Dutch were more frugal and industrious, that Dutch people are hardworking, the French more temperate and polite, the Germans more hardy and patient of labor and fatigue, and the Spaniard more staid and sedate. So here the author says that an impartial judge will describe all these things about the people of other nations. And here he has described the merits of French or Dutch or Germans. And about Englishmen, he further says that they are more sedate than the English. He has compared all these nations with the Englishmen, English nation, who, though undoubtedly brave and just, an Englishman, there is no doubt that an Englishman is brave and generous, were at the same time rash, headstrong and impetuous. But there are some demerits also present in an Englishman, that they are obstinate people. They are too apt to be elated with prosperity. They are very happy when they are prosperous, and too despondent in adversity, and they become very depressed when they are in adversity.